Good morning. Thank you very much for the invitation to come here and speak about our novel research. The theme this morning is, as me mentioned, the novel in the Anthropocene. And it's my task to be diving into some of the scientific background for the current assessment of the situation of the novels. I don't think it has gone unnoticed that novels are subject to a heated debate in Greenland, but the novel has been around for more than a million years, and it wasn't until recently it hit the front page of Semitchak. So it is a new thing that novels are being exposed to human activities, and the rise in activity during the Anthropocene is a concern, since novels are not very flexible and have difficulties habituating to the development in the Arctic. These developments include not just hunting pressure, but also traffic in pristine areas, ecosystem changes, and simple effects of ocean warming. The title of my presentation is, of course, a bit misleading, and I must hurry to explain that not all novel populations are included. The world population is likely larger than 100,000 individuals. Most of them are found in Canada. But the problem is that this world population is atomized into a number of smaller populations, of which some of them are at risk of disappearing. One population that is in a particularly difficult situation is the one in East Greenland. And I'll bring you straight to the conclusion to underline the seriousness of the situation. Here you see a catch curve from Scoresby Sound, and you have gear on the x-axis and catches on the y-axis. It is a typical nightmare graph situation for a biologist, where there's first an initial level of small-scale exploitation that is then followed by a rapid increase when the demand increases and the improved techniques are introduced. After some years with a large level of exploitation, this is followed by a collapse of the catches, reflecting a severely reduced abundance. This is a classical example of poor management and has great similarities with the textbook example of the history of commercial whaling that ended in 1985. This is kind of the mother of all overexploitation scenarios. The observation of how the large whales were depleted within a century has since inspired a lot of fisheries management and the concept about sustainable yield, maximum sustainable yield levels, etc. And that has inspired a lot of fisheries to develop more, sustainable direction. But not all fisheries have inspired, because if we move closer to Greenland, we have the situation with another cod stock that had a total collapse about 30 years ago. Once upon a time, it was the most prolific fishery in the world. But despite numerous warnings from biologists that catches need to be reduced to ensure sustainable levels, nothing happened. The lobby for maintaining the fisheries was too strong, and the fishery continued with a large effort, and suddenly in January 1992, the cod had virtually disappeared from the banks off Newfoundland, and it hasn't recovered since. And all fishing, even sports fishing, has become prohibited for 40 years with detrimental consequences for the society. This is just to illustrate that there's sometimes a very high risk that the hated biologist may actually be right, and that the consequences of not listening to their advice can be severe. But we know very well from Greenland that cod and other pelagic fish stocks can move into new areas and temporarily invade these areas, but now doesn't have that capacity because they suffer from what's called philopatry or site fidelity, which is the scientific word for extreme homesickness. You have here, to the left, the global distribution of novels, and If you can't see it, I suggest you move a bit further forward here. But now they only occur in the Atlantic part of the Arctic, and the largest concentrations are found in the Canadian High Arctic, where they summer in fjord and inlets. The light brown areas are the summer habitats, and the dark brown areas are the winter grounds. Blue areas indicate the directions of the fall migration, and green and hatched areas are areas where they may be resident or where they perhaps are wintering. In East Greenland, you can see on the map, they have a much more narrow distribution along the coastline, and there's only one winter ground that is known today. It is, however, well known that there's no exchange between whales east and west of Greenland, which is also confirmed by genetic studies. To the right, you see an insert of Baffin Bay region, where the narwhals have been most intensively studied, and where migrations and winter grounds of several stocks are known from satellite tracking studies. It is at present not possible to discriminate genetically between the different stocks, but the satellite telemetry studies show strong site fidelity to both summer and winter grounds, and this feature is also used for the science-based management of the stocks. Some of the stocks winter in deep water areas of Baffin Bay, but mating occur later in spring when the whales are heading towards their summering areas. Even though mating may be possible between stocks, and that may be the reason for the lack of genetic diversity, it is likely that calves always learn the migration patterns by following their mothers to the distinct summering grounds. When focusing on the Baffin Bay situation for narwhals, it is critical for the assessment of the hunting in both Canada and Greenland that it includes the migrations between the two countries. For instance, one stock that is harvested and counted in Canada in summer may be hunted in winter in Greenland, and perhaps together with weights from several other stocks. So left you see in different colors the summer grounds for each stock. There are two stocks in Greenland and six in Canada. And to the right you see the hunting communities in Canada and Greenland with the operational range of the hunters indicated. Usually the stocks are being surveyed counted at the summering grounds, and the art is then to assign the risk the summer stocks are exposed to of being hunted in different areas. The easy part is when a summer stock is hunted on a summer ground where it's also being counted. That is, for instance, the situation for narwhals in Enfield Blanding, see up here, that are hunted by the community of Kranach. You see that over here. The difficult situation is when the stock is hunted at separate hunting grounds. And to take that into account, a so-called allocation model has been developed. From the graph here, you can see, as to the left, you can see how the different stocks are assumed to contribute to the hunt in the various areas. Here you see the different stocks of narwhals, and here are the hunting localities. One stock we are particularly concerned about is the Melville Bay stock that is hunted in the Melville is the green one, sorry, that is hunted in Upernavik, but may also be exposed to hunting in Disco Bay. Another example is the Admiralty Inlet stock that is hunted in Arctic Bay, which is a community located inside Arctic Bay, but it may also be hunted in many other areas, including Disco Bay in winter. To the right here, you see a bit more complicated version of it, because here the probability of being hunted in the various communities are expressed as percentages. So there's a 99% that the hunt in Upernavik is taken from the Melville Bay stock, whereas the Uummannaq and Disco Bay has a much lower risk of taking animals from the Melville Bay stock. On the contrary, you can see here the Admiralty Inlet stock may be exposed to hunting in Arctic Bay, both in spring, summer and fall. Remember that Arctic Bay is a community inside Admiralty Inlet, but they may also be hunted in the Pond Inlet and even in Disco Bay. And you can see the worst situation is in Disco Bay, where many different stocks, you have all the stocks up here, where many different stocks may contribute to the harvest. This is a novel approach for a multi-stock situation that is managed in a bilateral arrangement or international arrangement, and it may inspire, or we hope it will inspire also fish stock assessment, and could also be used for birds. One stock we are particularly concerned about is the Mellow Bay stock, because it is small and we have detected a reduction in habitat use. Air surveys have been conducted since 2007, and they show that the area used by the whales during their stay in the bay has declined dramatically. From in the past, they use all four stratum areas. These are the dots here from the 2007 surveys, and it dropped from in 2012 to only two of them, and in the last survey in 19, there's only one area that's being used, and that is a warning signal that something troubling is going on in the population, and we don't quite understand what it is. Let us now move on to the East Greenland situation, where we have a similar multi-stock situation, but it's only the southern stocks that is being harvested. That's the Scoresby Sound stock, the Karlslusvåg, and the Sealer. These are the narrow stocks that are the biggest troubles today and has the highest risk of disappearing in the very near future. As an example, I will go through the Scoresby Sound situation. This is a typical summer stock that is summering in here, and some weeks before ice forms, they will move out here and they will be wintering here at the edge of the continental shelf, and by June, July, they will be moving back into the fjord system. The first sign that there was something terribly wrong with the population in East Greenland appeared in 2014. Since 2010, narwhals have been live captured and tagged with satellite transmitters in Scoresby Sound, and the tracks confirmed the extreme size fidelity, so typical for narwhals. But in 2014, a whale that was tagged in 2013, this is the same whale here, was caught by the hunters at the very same beach and where it was initially captured, and on the very same calendar day in August where the initial capture happened. He was still carrying the satellite transmitter from 2013. This is in itself an indication that the population must be small, since what is the chance of recapturing a tag whale in a large population? And since the 1993, several hundred narwhals have been tagged in Canada and Greenland, and we have never seen a recapture before. But after 2014, about 10 whales, additional 10 whales have been recaptured in the area. And that's out of an accumulated, or out of a total number of tagged animals of 65 over the years and accumulated 500. So it's indeed a very worrisome situation with all these recaptures. The animals are virtually coming back to the same area every year. A simple recapture population model suggests that the population size of about 500 animals, much too low a population to sustain harvest in the magnitude of 50 whales per year or any catches at all. Population assessments rely on abundance estimates from the summering grounds, and the concern about the situation for narwhals in East Greenland and other places in Greenland has triggered a number of air surveys for abundance estimations. The surveys are done with line transect measures with double observers to correct for whales that are missed by the observers, and the at surface estimates are corrected for whales that are submerged below the surface during the survey, with data from recorders that record the time the whales spend at the surface, where they can be seen by the observers. I won't go into the details of the measures here, but just mention that both measures and results are being intensively scrutinized by scientists in both the North Atlantic Marine Mammal Commission and the Joint Commission for the Conservation and Management of Narwhal and Beluga in Canada and Greenland. So left you see an area of an example of the area that's been covered by one of these surveys along the coastline of Southeast Greenland. And as you can see, that we have very few sightings in the southern part, and that's actually the area where we have difficulties locating the population. And even though they're still being hunted there, but very low numbers. So this is a killer slide. I have to apologize that for those of you that are still awake, you may see that there are some figures up here that's quite important, because I want to take you into the so-called machine room of the assessment process. And you see here seven different panels of population models, and it is showing the years on the x-axis and the abundance of whales on the y-axis, and the abundance are here in thousands. So when it says one, it means 1,000, when it says two, it means 2,000. But you have here four different models that are exploring the population development under different parameter settings. And the basic data that enters the model is absolute abundance estimates, which are abundance estimates that are fully corrected for animals that are submerged during the survey and animals that are missed by the observers. And then there are some relative abundance estimates that we're not as sure about how well they reflect the population size at that time. Then the catch history that I also showed on one of the first slides, I included here, and you can see the catch history matches quite well the population model, so to speak, that when you have no catches, you have kind of flat population development. When you have high catches, the population is declining. So the first four models up here are models where we explore different birth rates and keeping the adult survival constant. And number five here is a situation where we assume a two-stock situation where one stock is being caught after 1st of July. And we have one here where we exclude the information we have about the age structure of the caches. And then we have one here where there's only one abundance estimate that's being used. It's just kind of a baseline model, but that's not accepted by the scientific working group. But the one that was accepted as giving the most, and I won't go into detail about the selection process here, but the model that gives the most realistic scenario is this one here, and it gives a adult survival of 97% and the current population, model population size of only 380 animals. That's the model you also see here on this graph here. Well, perhaps it's easier to see here. So this is a population trajectory, and this is how it's going down the hill. Based on this projections, it can be advised that catches of a certain magnitude will allow to increase with a certain probability within the next 5 years. In this example from the population DLW that was selected before, it is shown to the table on the right. This is actually the advice. That catches of 10 whales per year down here will leave us with a probability of an increase in population over 5 years of only 11%. So if you go out and do the survey again 5 years later, then there's an 11% chance that there will be more whales than there was in the survey we did recently. And if you only catch one animal per year in the next 5 years, then there's still only a 57% of a larger population size after 5 years. In Greenland, it becomes standard, it's often requested that there should be at least a 70% chance for a larger population when examined 5 years later. So this is indeed a unsustainable situation, and that further catches will evidently lead to a declined population size. Based on this type of assessment, it was recommended that caches in 2019 should be less than 20 in area 1, this area here, and that caches in the two other areas should be 0. This recommendation was strengthened to 0 for all three units in Southeast Greenland in 2020 when the last assessment was completed. Even though there's a gradual reduction of quota following the advice, the catches are still too high to be sustainable and will represent a near-term risk of the extinction of the tree stocks. A new assessment just completed last week emphasizes this and says that the risk is perhaps even higher than we have seen here, and we're talking about the risk of extinction within the coming few years. There are additional data from the Scoresby Sound stock that also indicate there's been a shift in age structure over time, and that young whales are not as frequently observed in the hunt as in the past. Also, when looking at the body length and body mass of the hunt, there's a substantial increase for both females and males, and for males also for the tusk length. You have here the years, and then you have the changes in mass of the animals and size of the animals. At the same time, the probability of catching a female and even a pregnant female, you see that over here in this graph here, also with a year on the x-axis, the probability of catching a female and even a pregnant female has also declined over time, and both in the data collected by the biologist, that is the blue one here, and the data reported by the hunters from their caste registration. So the population has become a zombie population, whereas mainly old males with the last tusk that are left. So what is driving this level of overexploitation? Well, the main incentive for owl hunting in Greenland is not the tusk, as many of you may believe, but rather the skin, the also called meddik of the whale, that is considered a delicacy. The price for this has increased from 50 kroner per kilo in 1982 to 500 kroner per kilo in 2019, the price that exceeds the price of all other hunting products. The whale skin on that deck is transported from the hunting communities to the towns where it's sold locally, so it is a domestic commercial market that drives the trade. On average, an owl can provide 130 kilo of medpack, or that corresponds to a value of 66,000 kroner in retail price. The driver behind this raise in price is, of course, an increasing demand by the consumers, which increases the price to an extent where the price is still above the ever-increasing cost of the hunting operations. But cost of hunting operations are also partly compensated by government subsidies, and the increasing demand and the increasing price and the increasing surplus are the main incentive by the increasing hunt. The increasing hunt is behind the reduction in abundance of some stocks, and one effect is the rain contraction that I showed in the example from the Melville Bay. External factors like climate change and disturbance may also contribute to the range contraction, but for the hunters it appears that the density of whales is the same. There still seem to be abundance in the areas they go looking for them, but they are now found in a much smaller area, and eventually the density here will also decline, and that is the roadway to extinction. But climate change is indeed also part of the equation, and is also contributing to the range contractions. Here you see a map with the sea ice distribution around Greenland in August 1938. Most of this August ice can no longer be found. Nowadays, the whole coast of East Greenland is generally ice-free in August. Owls may not depend on sea ice, and they may not even like the ice. That is just a dangerous barrier. But owls do like it cold, and during winter the pack ice is a refuge that protects an owl from hunters and killer whales and other things, and then here they can make their deep dives and search for halibuts. The whales use echolocation, where searching for prey at depths and buses and clicks are used for capturing prey, and as can be seen on the figure here to the right, the highest intensity of the buzzing activity usually occurs at depths at 300 to 600 meters, where the temperature is between 0 and 1 degree Celsius. If we then compare the abundance of owls at the different localities with the average sea surface temperature at the locality, then clearly the largest owl stocks are found in the coldest areas in northern Canada. You have here, this is the abundance of owls, and here over here you have sea surface temperature that's following this curve here. So this is the abundance estimates from Canada. This is from Melville Bay in Greenland. This is the area over here. And then you have Mid East here, that's the Scoresby Sound area, and you have the South East here, that's the Sealand. But this whole box represents these areas here, and you can see here that with increasing temperature there's a kind of a drop in abundance levels. Similarly here, if you take all the localities and look a simple regression of the sea surface temperature with abundance against sea surface temperature, you can also see a decline here where all the red and the violet dots are the Greenland situation. So in conclusion, more owls are found in colder waters. The temperature in the Arctic is for various reasons increasing faster than in other areas of the planet, and the prediction for the future is that there will be a general warming of the North Atlantic that for areas east and western Greenland is expected to amount to 0.4 degrees Celsius per decade until the year 2100. For now, this will mean that they will lose substantial areas of the habitat, and that the decline we already see in southeast Greenland because of overexploitation will be accelerated. I hope you can see on this map here to the left here, this is kind of the current distribution of optimal owl habitat in Greenland and Canada. This is the projection for 2030. You can see some areas here in southeast Greenland being lost, whereas new habitat seems to appear up in northern Canada. And this is the projection for 2100, where the winter habitat in East Greenland is virtually gone, and now they may have retracted up here. There's perhaps very little we can do about this situation. Some areas further north may be the new habitat, but there's also a limit to how far north now they can, the narwhals can move, since they don't seem to be very flexible. Clearly, there are a number of factors that threaten or influence the abundance of narwhals. Ice entrapment used to cause severe mortalities, but they have been very rare in the past 15-20 years because of the milder winter climate. Killer whales and polar bears are also predators of narwhals, but usually of low importance, and like for ice entrapments, they can be considered part of the natural mortality, where they may replace mortality from other factors. Global warming affects the habitat and the distribution of the whales, but will only in long-term scenarios be a mortality factor. Ship traffic, that we'll hear more about in the next presentation, is a disturbance and may be a mortality in some areas with extreme densities, but not a problem in Greenland, but potentially a problem in Canada. But the biggest threat is undoubtedly the increasing range of hunters and hunting that has happened with the introduction of fast and big motorboats that can carry a bigger load and cover larger areas, much larger than was practiced in the past. Well, it's not just in Semichak that there's been a heated debate about narwhal management, but also in the prestigious journal Science, where there recently was an exchange of opinions between biologists and anthropologists, where the anthropologists argued that Greenland, instead of relying on biological advice that's not being followed anyway, Greenland should instead rely on information from communities. The anthropologists argued that hunters' knowledge should be taken seriously and that local communities should be integrated as key participants in establishing community-based management and monitoring. There are numerous problems with that approach, but it be clear that the hunters, they are indeed experts and know their animals and their surrounding extremely well. There's no question about that. But it's also a very lousy and unsuccessful biologist that doesn't take advantage of the hunter's knowledge and incorporate that in her studies. When it comes to the more abstract concept about the status of stocks, there are several things that we need to be aware of. One of the more obvious ones is that the hunters are not a homogeneous group, but their opinions of the status of stocks can go in very different directions. One skilled hunter may claim that the narwhals are extirpated, whereas another hunter, or probably perhaps a member of the being a union representative, claim that there are plenty of narwhals. Which one do we choose to believe? We also need to keep in mind that hunters are economically dependent on the resource. That's the same with fishermen and farmers and others that are using living resources. And that cannot be separated from their perception of the status of the stocks. In this context, it should be mentioned that there may also be other stakeholders that hunters that have an invested interest in the resource. It could be the tourist industry or the fishing industry. And for the long-term perspective, hunters, like everybody else, suffer from the shifting baseline syndrome, which is our fading memory of how conditions were in the past. This eventually lowers the perception of the baseline of the ecological conditions we ideally want the systems to return to. Nobody remember all the water fallouts that used to be in Greenland, or the plentiful bird cliffs that long ago were abandoned by the birds, let alone the belugas that used to swim in the fjord just outside from where we are today. Natural science is good for reconstructing what we don't remember. We can use a variety of methods, including population models, I'm sure, genetic methods and geological studies to reconstruct the past. We can also do projections for the future. Finally, and most importantly, is the integrity of the science. If we mix natural science with hunters and knowledge from other stakeholders to make a compromise that keeps everybody, and especially the politician, happy, then the natural science part has lost its value and integrity. You don't question or debate your disease with your doctor or force him to make a compromise on his diagnosis. You listen to his advice as it is, and then you may go and do something else. Thank you.